1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Oh. Professor Duncan, the Vice Principal Academic, FAS.
Professor Serena Kutsia, Head of Department of the Department of Geography, Geoinformatics and Meteorology, and distinguished guests, thank you for joining us this evening at this auspicious event. I'd like to hand over to Professor Duncan for the formal welcome and to introduce our speaker. Professor Duncan.
Professor Erasmus, Vice Chancellor and Principal, Professor Tawana Kupe, other members of the University Executive, members of the University Council and Senate, Professor Barend Erasmus, Dean of the Faculty of Natural and Agricultural Sciences, Deputy Dean, Teaching and Learning, Professor Paulette Bloomer, Deputy Dean, Research and Postgraduate Education, Professor Vinesh Maharaj, other academics from the University of Pretoria, as well as colleagues from other institutions of higher education, students, Professor Serena Kutsia, Professor Kutsia's family and friends, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, it is my signal pleasure to welcome you on behalf of the Vice Chancellor and Principal of the University of Pretoria to the inaugural address of Professor Serena Kutsia. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, you will acknowledge that we are living through a period of extraordinary turbulence and change that has required drastic and ongoing adjustments, including in the university sector. While the University of Pretoria prides itself in its flexibility and its ability to manage and facilitate change when change is required, it also strives to foster continuity of that which it holds dear, such as academic excellence and the rigor and depth of the scholarship embodied by its senior academics. Of course, the University of Pretoria counts amongst its own a large number of senior academics who epitomize academic rigor and excellence. This includes excellence in research, teaching, innovation, and international engagement. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, based on my reading of Professor Serena Kutsia's academic resume, particularly in relation to her contributions to research, teaching, and service to professional and scientific bodies, she certainly can be viewed as an exemplary member of this grouping of scholars. Given that she is a full professor, she has been invited to present this inaugural lecture this evening. And now, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, allow me to introduce Professor Serena Kutsia to you. Professor Kutsia was awarded an MSc in Computer Science cum laude from the University of Pretoria in 1997. In 2009, she obtained a PhD degree in Computer Science, also from the University of Pretoria. In 2018, she was appointed as Professor and Head of the Department of Geography, Geoinformatics and Meteorology at the University of Pretoria. Professor Kutsia started a career as a software engineer on global software development teams of desktop geographic information systems, or GIS, products. Subsequently, as Director and Project Manager at AFRI GIS, she led various GIS projects ranging from geospatial data collection, manipulation and maintenance, to geocoding, spatial analysis, and internet GIS. She joined the University of Pretoria in 2006. Professor Kutsia's research focuses on the exponentially increasing volumes of available geographic information and the challenges of making the information available, accessible, and usable. Her research is of an interdisciplinary nature, but focus mainly in geoinformatics and computer science. The construct Spatial Data Infrastructure, or SDI, underlies much of her research, which contributes to understanding and improving spatial data infrastructure practice and theory. Address data standards, open principles, and geovisualization constitute the key foci of her research. Her research has revealed the delicate balance between stakeholders across different levels of government when making national address data available, accessible, and usable. Professor Kutsia has published prolifically in a field of research, both in the form of journal articles and technical reports, and currently has an NRFC 1 rating. Professor Kutsia chairs the Commission on SDIs and Standards of the International Cartographic Association. She actively participates in international geographic information standardization efforts through the International Organization for Standardization's Technical Committee, ISO TC 2011. At the national level, she participates in the South African Bureau of Standards, MIRA Committee. She was the project lead for different parts of the South African Address Standard, SANS 1883. From 2016 to 2020, Professor Kutsia represented the Council on Higher Education on the South African Committee for Spatial Information. The Committee for Spatial Information coordinates the implementation of the South African spatial data infrastructure. During the same period, she represented the Council on Higher Education on the South African Geomatics Council. In 2019, Professor Kutsia was a finalist in the T.W. Kambule National Science and Technology Foundation Awards and the runner-up in the Geoinformation Society of South Africa's Award for the Advancement of the Geospatial Industry. Earlier, she received an award from the Universal Postal Union in their 2015 Addressing Solution Design and Challenge, and an SABS award in recognition of a contribution to the development of SANS 1883 in 2009. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I now invite Professor Kutsia to present her inaugural lecture titled The Geospatial Information Ecosystem of the Future. Over to you, Prof.
Thank you, Prof. Duncan, Prof. Erasmus, and everybody out there. So this evening, I would like to share with you my research to date and what I plan to focus on in future. My research has always focused on the ever-increasing volumes of geospatial information and the challenges of making this information available, accessible, and usable. So geospatial or geographic information is any information concerning phenomena implicitly or explicitly associated with the location relative to the Earth. Examples are place names, addresses, information about rivers, information about tweets, and this information could be above the ground or below the surface of the Earth. And the concept of spatial data infrastructures underlies much of my research. Now, we all are familiar with the term infrastructure, and we know it from physical infrastructures. If we open a tap, out comes water. If we flick a switch, on goes the light. And this is made possible behind the scenes because of the infrastructure. Or at least it's supposed to be like that. I know in South Africa, the physical infrastructures are currently under immense pressure. So in the 1980s and 1990s, when there was a move from information on paper to digital information, the concept of data or information infrastructure emerged. And it is based on this concept of a physical infrastructure. And this metaphor was then also applied to geospatial information or geospatial data, and it was called a spatial data infrastructure. And there are many examples of such spatial data infrastructures today. They have been developed for countries, for different regions like the European Union, for organizations like the United Nations, or they have been developed for specific topics or themes. So most of the time, they are visible through a portal or digital library where one can find and download geospatial information. And my research focuses on spatial data infrastructures, and today I want to explain to you why we need to think a bit bigger than just the infrastructure metaphor. I also focus on address data, which is a fundamental geospatial data set of a spatial data infrastructure. I focus on standards, which make the geospatial information interoperable and therefore facilitate making the data usable. I have focused on open data and open software, which simplify the way in which you use geospatial information, because usually there's no permission required, and most of the time they're also free. And I also look at geovisualization and maps, because if you have large volumes of data and you want to make those usable and accessible to people to understand, then you have to visualize those large volumes of data. So in my research, I have looked at SEIs from different perspectives. We have modeled them according to the RMODP, that's Open Distributed Processing. It's an international standard. And we looked at the computational viewpoint. One of my PhD students, Edward, is looking at the SDI as a supply chain. We have compared SDIs for different countries, specifically some in Africa. We have looked at the role of value-added resellers and volunteer geographic information and how they impact spatial data infrastructures. Daniel Sebake looked at the motivators and barriers for address data sharing. Sami looked at how we can use search engine optimization for improved geospatial data discovery. And then right in the beginning, still one of my computer science students looked at service level agreements and how what that impact is of them in the cloud on geoprocessing. And then finally, we've also worked with spatial data infrastructures on different themes, so such as spatial planning or even spatial data infrastructures in research and academia. Now, standards facilitate interoperability, and they therefore make data accessible and usable. And I've been very actively involved in the development of standards for geospatial information, and specifically address data. And before one can develop a standard, one has to understand what you are dealing with. So for the South African address, the first thing that we did is to describe addresses in use in South Africa. And we came up with 12 different kinds of addresses. These are now formally described in the South African Addressing Standard, that's SANS 1883, and those standards also explain how you can exchange that address data. Then, following the South African Addressing Standard, we initiated the development of an international addressing standard, ISO 19160. So the idea was not to standardize and make all the addresses all over the world the same. The idea is to provide a conceptual model and to provide the tools so that people in different countries can describe the addresses that they use. And then because they can describe what the addresses look like, that data can be exchanged. And then through my involvement in the ISO TC211 committee, that's the ISO Technical Committee for Geographic Information and Geomatics, I've looked at dependencies between different standards. There are now more than 70 of them. So it becomes an issue if one standard gets revised, how does it impact on other standards? And one has to make sure that all of this stays in sync. We've looked at the evolution of the metadata standard, ISO 19115. That was one of the first standards that got published, and it's gone through a couple of revisions. We've looked at standards for making geospatial information discoverable, accessible, and usable, and also how standards contribute to sustainable development. And we looked there also at different case studies from different countries. Drawing on my background in computer science and software engineering, I've contributed also towards designing software that properly visualizes and maps geospatial information so that the information gets correctly communicated. So early on, one of my first master students, Victoria, demonstrated how to orchestrate different web services for producing thematic maps. Recently, Bole Lang designed data structures for visual analytics of geospatial sensor observations. Together with Yvette, we looked at how we can use procedural modeling to speed up the development of 3D models of informal settlements. Dani looked at the development frameworks for displaying addresses in augmented reality, as you can see there on that mobile picture in the background. And then together with Victoria also, we developed design patterns. So based on design patterns that are used in computer science teaching, we designed something that can be used for making maps. And these are tools that software developers can use when they write programs that design maps. But the one side is writing the software. The other side is also understanding how users perceive that information. And so especially with colleagues overseas, we've looked at a few usability studies. For example, Victoria developed a task taxonomy, so it explains all the different tasks that are involved when one reads a map. With Gertrude, we developed three-dimensional, or we used a third dimension for visualizing wind speed uncertainty, and we looked at how experts perceived that. And then with Amy and Arzu, we're looking at landform perception. So if you see, like in Google Maps, you see an aerial photograph, Some of those valleys could be perceived as ridges, and some ridges could be perceived as valleys. And we are trying to understand when that is the case so that one can make sure that these things are interpreted accurately. Now, when the spatial data infrastructure concept was applied to spatial information in the 1990s, by that time, infrastructures, the physical infrastructures, originated from the 1800s, and they had evolved into these large, very large technical organizations with central control. They were mostly driven by supply, and they were typically focusing on specialists who delivered services or some form of product to others. And when Brendan and I did a review of SDI literature in 2015, we saw that over the years, many people had observed that spatial data infrastructures were evolving. So they were moving away from a centralized control. They were evolving in response to mobile technologies and crowdsourcing. Some people observed that especially these government-driven infrastructures were very slow to evolve or change and respond to some of the technologies. And there were even some who said, well, they're probably going to disappear one day. And in a related study where we looked at the abstracts of the journals affiliated with the International Cartographic Association, you can see the evolution of visualization and mapping. So what is listed there is all the words and the word counts. So the ones at the top are the words that occurred most frequently in the abstracts of these journals. And you can see how things like method and data moved up from being very, very seldomly used to very frequently used. And then maps are also going down in frequency. So I think this is interesting. So data took a lot of prominence. If I can predict the future, I think maps and visualization are going to go up again because we are now at a stage where we have lots of data and the challenge is going to be in visualization again. Another thing that happened in the evolution of SDIs is that Web 2.0 made it possible to contribute geospatial information. And one of the prominent examples of this is OpenStreetMap. It was established in 2004 or 2005. It's a free and editable map of the world. Anybody can contribute and anybody can use the data. And through the Youth Mappers, it's an international organization, and we also have a chapter at the University of Pretoria that Cameron and Victoria run. We conducted a lot of mapathons at the university where we had students, as you can see there on the photo, contributing data. We mapped, for example, the Melusi and the Alaska informal settlements where our geoinformatics students also work. We experimented with the interplay between hackathons and mapathons and what the differences are and how they could work together. And Cameron then also tried to evaluate student productivity and motivation. So especially trying to evaluate this on the long run or to motivate students to keep on contributing. And this is kind of developed in a quest to understand who contributes to OpenStreetMap, especially in South Africa, and how they contribute. And I'll say a bit more about that just now. Now, in all our research about SDIs, something is very prominently missing, and that's the municipalities. So if you look at the scientific literature related to SDI, they usually use the label SDI for top-down government initiatives. That SDI label is not used where there's a bottom-up approach where municipalities or even citizens are involved. In a study of the buildings and address register in the Netherlands, we found that there's a very delicate balance between the local and national interests if you take databases or data sets from a municipality and integrate that into a national data set. And in a similar study in Flanders and in Belgium, we found that when they merged the geospatial and the general e-government agency, the municipalities had even less influence. And all of this implies influence means somebody else is going to tell the municipalities what they have to do, but the municipalities use that data to manage their cities, and it's very important to them, whereas on a national level, that data is used for a different purpose. So it's important to balance these interests and these influences. And then recently, together with Sammy and Anthony, we did a study for the GCRO where we looked at who could be responsible for a national data set in South Africa. And the question there is, there are lots of contenders who could do this, but the question is who would be able to work in the best way with the municipalities and balance those interests between them. Now, if you also look at a spatial data infrastructure as a distributed architecture, you can see here the digital SDI. That was when we moved from paper to digital information. It's very much a flow from left to right, and that happened on a personal computer. Then when the servers were added, it was now possible to involve the users. So the users could also design maps, but remember, in the early days of the internet, we only had read-only servers. So later on, it was also possible, when Web 2.0 arrived, it was also possible to contribute data to the SDI, like we saw also with OpenStreetMap. And then these days, the sensors are everywhere. The data comes from everywhere. It's always in the cloud. So we're moving into a new area where there's not so much control about where the data is. It is everywhere, and it changes everything. Which brings me to the fourth industrial revolution, which we all know is happening right now. It's driven by the development and adoption of technology such as the Internet of Things, ubiquitous computing, artificial intelligence. And while we don't yet know how all of this is going to pan out, we do know that things are happening at a speed and a scope and a size that we've never seen before. And we also know that this will lead to an interconnectedness of people, devices, and information anytime, anywhere. And because of that, location-based information will be much more important than in the past. So for all these reasons, it's time for a new way to think about how geospatial information is made available, how it's accessed, and how it's used. Now, the natural ecosystem has been used as a metaphor in the world of data and digital ecosystems. And we can also apply that metaphor to geospatial information. And then the geospatial information ecosystem becomes a community of providers and users in conjunction with the geospatial information and technologies of the environment. And all of this is interacting as a system. So you can see it's still a system thinking, but it's a much wider scope of the systems thinking. So going forward, I think it will be interesting to describe this geospatial information ecosystem in a lot more detail. If we draw or look at the definitions that are provided for data and digital ecosystems, the characteristics that are given is that they are open, they are adaptive, it's a socio-technical system, it self-organizes, and in other words, there's no centralized, not even distributed control. There are many agents, they are distributed all over the globe, and there's loosely coupled collaboration between them. And I think it would be interesting to have a formal description. Some of the ICA colleagues did that for spatial data infrastructure, develop a UML model for this, and I think it would also be interesting to do that for an ecosystem, to look at which kinds of agents they are they keystone agents, how is diversity having an impact, and so forth. And I've been invited to a discussion with colleagues at Urogi, where we are looking at the geospatial ecosystem. So that's broader than just the geospatial information ecosystem. And that's been a very fascinating discussion that also influenced my ideas for today. And I'm looking forward to taking that further. Then coming back to the municipalities, there is still much to do towards integrating them into spatial data infrastructures, and then also to understand what will their role be in this geospatial information infrastructure of the future. Sorry, ecosystem of the future. Particularly in South Africa, where many municipalities are under-resourced. So they don't have the resources to manage their geospatial information, and therefore we must maybe get the national mapping agencies to help. So Lindy Ann, my PhD student, is, for example, looking at that, how we can capacitate the municipalities in the context of a spatial data infrastructure. The question will also come up, how does one balance the local and the national interests? And then I think generally, what is the role of e-government? So spatial and all kinds of other digital have very often moved in parallel. I think it's time to integrate that because location-based information is important for government generally. It's not only for other kinds of applications anymore. And then in the context of that also, I think it would be interesting to study OpenStreetMap and see where Something that is already available to everybody can be used by the municipalities. For sure, there are some things that need to be certified or authoritative. If you think about land tenure, where it may not be possible. But I think there are many other applications where OpenStreetMap could be used. But in order to do that, one needs to understand who contributes to the OpenStreetMap data and when can this data be trusted, because anybody can contribute it. And so some of my students, such as Dani, is, for example, looking at that, trying to understand when we can trust OpenStreetMap data. An ecosystem, if you remember, is based on collaboration and competition. So if you want to survive in this ecosystem, you have to compete and you have to adapt all the time. The question is whether people in South Africa are ready for such a geospatial information ecosystem. So a recent study of a PhD student of mine, Susanne, she found that habit actually determines why people choose a certain software. So they did not consider cost benefits, customizability, improved reliability, quality, security, nothing like that. They just based it on what software they know, and that's the software that they used. We are now also looking at seeing whether there's any influence of age, gender, experience, or professional registration in this. And I think it would be interesting to repeat this study in other countries or other communities to understand whether we are unique in South Africa or whether this is something that applies everywhere else. Because I think it will be interesting in the end to understand how open source software can impact competition and collaboration in a geospatial information ecosystem. Because generally open source software is assumed to level the playing field. And so in terms of competition in an ecosystem, I think this will be an interesting topic of research. Then in a world of ever-increasing volumes of geospatial information, where things are automated through software, it's important that computer science and IT professionals have access to cartographic knowledge so that they can design software that guides users towards making maps that appropriately communicate geospatial information. So computer science technical people typically have a very different background to somebody who comes from geography or cartography and knows how to design a map. And together with colleagues at the International Cartographic Association, we are exploring how this could be done. For example, by making terminology available. So there is already cartographic terminology. We could make this available generally. By identifying dependencies between design choices, and that's the diagram that Victoria prepared there that looks like that, so that you know when you prepare software, if you go down this root of the tree, then you have to go back if you want to end up at a different kind of map. Or by designing ontologies, workflows, and design patterns. And these are things that technical people then can use when they develop software. And this is turning out to be a very interesting marriage between computational thinking, that's developing an algorithm or a process to get something done. Then there are people who are good at spatial thinking, that's understanding the spatial relationships between phenomena. And there's design thinking, and that's the process of designing or improving an artifact such as a map. So it's three very different ways of thinking that one needs to combine in order to develop tools so that people can make maps that communicate information appropriately. And in this same group of people at the ICA, we are also looking at standardizing terminology, especially that terminology that emerged after the last multilingual cartographic dictionary was published in 1997. So there are new words that are now frequently used, like zoom and pan, and there are general purpose definitions for these, but there may be a need to redefine these for specifically working with online maps. And then very shockingly, most African languages do not have the words for describing a map in a COVID-19 dashboard. So they have to borrow words from other languages in order to do this. And so I invited former and current students and colleagues from South Africa, and we are looking at preparing terms and definitions so that such maps can be described and explained in African languages. And so as a starter, I think it's a bit small there on the screen, but as a starter, we translated International Cartographic Association into all these different languages. And even that was a bit of a challenge. Some of the colleagues and students had to ask their parents to help them because they didn't know the words. And the list, if you can, I think you cannot read it there. So it's Amharic, isiXhosa, isiZulu, Sepedi, Setswana, Swahili, Twi, which is from Ghana, and Yoruba, and Sichonga. So we hope that sometime this year or next year, we'll have those terms in the African languages. Then regarding my research on address data, I'm very excited that this is moving beyond data. So internationally, I'm leading now the project, the ISO standard on assigning and maintaining addresses for objects in the physical world. So hopefully that will facilitate addressing those people who don't have an address. Yashina also has looked at alternative ways of addressing in informal settlements, because there's often not a road network, or the road network keeps on changing, or there's not a road where a vehicle can go between the houses. So we looked at different ways of working in informal settlements. And then we're also looking at the value and importance of having an address in South Africa and the perceptions of people about that. So Azila interviewed people in informal settlements and asked them, why do they think they should have an address, and do they think it's an important thing, and if they would have an address, would it change their lives? So that's very interesting, and Sharti is continuing on that in the same vein and looking at policy guidance. And then in the context of women's perceptions and place guidelines, we are going to look at this, how an address influences somebody's sense of place and how all of this changed due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Then finally, in my research, the wider use of geospatial information is also reflected. You can see there the different topics and the different application domains in which students are working. It goes from environmental management, which is maybe more than what one would expect, to archaeology, where Brenda is designing a digital geospatial environment. It's got a story map and a 3D model of a pre-colonial city. And we're looking at how users perceive this information and whether this could be used for learning about pre-colonial cities in Southern Africa. So these are all the different domains that I work in, but obviously colleagues work in even more domains. Now, in the past, at the University of Pretoria, we mostly educated specialists in the use of geospatial information technologies, and we also educated in how providing this information and the technologies and how all of this can be improved. And you can see there the academic programs and the offerings where these things are taught. But in the future, in the geospatial information ecosystem, this user base of geospatial information will explode. It will expand. So everybody is using geospatial information. And I think all of you out there are already familiar with things like WhatsApp, where you can share location and Google Maps and navigating. Everybody is using that information these days. So as a result, we have more users, but there are more students also needed for providing geospatial information and technologies and also improving them, also at the MSc and the PhD level. And I think something that makes the University of Pretoria special is that we also have the computer science and information systems students in our class, so that they can integrate this geospatial knowledge into the information systems, the general purpose information systems, such as e-government systems, when they start working. So similar to computer science and statistics, geoinformatics is becoming a discipline that's relevant in almost every other application domain. The world is changing faster than ever before, and it is also having a profound impact on how geospatial information is made available, accessible, and usable. The infrastructure metaphor, I think, will remain useful, but the ecosystem metaphor expand systems thinking beyond that of an infrastructure. And I think that is what we need going forward. So standards, address data, open software, geovisualization, and maps, these will all still play an important role in the future, but with a much broader and wider scope. So as you could hear throughout my presentation, there are lots of other people involved when you do research. It's never just one person doing research, and I would like to here acknowledge all my co-authors over the years. You can see all the names there in the Wordle. You can see my former PhD students like Victoria and Anthony. They come out, and even Sammy come out larger than all the others. But there's been so many people with who I collaborated on all this research. And I would also like to thank all the funders and all the conversations and collaborations in the geospatial information community, not only in South Africa, but also internationally. Many of the ideas for research and how they develop come out of conversations, drinking a glass of wine, having a beer, and I would like to acknowledge that and thank you all for that. And then on a more personal note, I would like to thank my parents for being an example and always supporting me. When my father was still alive, he would send us a birthday card every year, and he would spend lots of time finding the right quote for the right birthday every year. And this one is one that I found especially valuable in my career as an educator, especially early on when I didn't know how really to deal with students. So if you have been to my office, you'll have seen it pinned up on my notice board. It's already fading because it's 10 years old, but it's still very relevant. And then lastly, thank you to Jan, who's here in the studio tonight, and Cara and Max, who are hopefully watching from Germany if they're not studying. Thanks for always being there for me. And also to all the other family members who are listening tonight, my mother, sisters, brother, sisters and brothers-in-law, nephews, nieces, cousins, uncles and aunts. Family is really the anchor in one's life, and I would like to acknowledge and thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Goodseer, for that insightful inaugural lecture. Colleagues and friends, I think it is clear that we have significant scholarship and significant achievement here, and it gives me great pleasure to celebrate that this evening, celebrate the attainment of the rank of full professor for Professor Goodseer. It's no simple achievement. What struck me from the lecture is the deep intertwinement of scholarship and industry. I think there's few better examples of how deep scholarship in the field of geoinformation sciences support a large industry. And when I refer to industry, this is not something far off, and this is not something that we don't frequently interact with. In this particular case, this is the industry of location-based services, and that's something that we carry in our pockets each and every day. So I really like the example of this transdisciplinary research that impacts every single individual with a smartphone all across the world, how the interact with location-based data and the potential of location-based data in the future as a key fourth industrial revolution pillar to contribute to the development of the African continent. On a more personal note, I would also like to extend my thanks and congratulations to Professor Goodseer, not just for the scholarship that she brings into her department, but also the leadership that she brings to take this department into, into the next century, and also as one of the star performers within my faculty. Thank you very much. I'm also acutely aware that this level of performance, scholarly and also in terms of leadership, sometimes comes at a cost, and therefore I extend my deep thanks to the domestic support system that Prof. Goodseer has already referred to. So thank you very much for that, much appreciated. Finally, also like to thank the executive of the University of Pretoria for making this event possible, and for its support and recognizing that this is a benchmark in the career of any senior academic. Thank you very much to the Department of Institutional Advancement, and in particular, also thank you to the marketing department of my faculty, in particular Marie Venter, for making this event possible and all the logistical arrangements. And last but not least, thank you very much to Spatial Studios for making this event as professional as it is. Colleagues, in closing, thank you very much for joining us. Have a good evening and look after yourselves. The third wave is upon us. Good night.